Very good morning to all of you. I today Piraj Mojumdar welcomes you to Make Pro classes of our Operation Research series. Today we are going to have our session on dynamic programming, which comes under the module 7 of your mechanical engineering syllabus. And in the previous one of this particular module, we have solved the nonlinear programming problem by graphical method. We have also seen the different methods like direct search method, steepest descent method, Lagrangian multipliers method, integer programming we have solved by using branch and bound technique. So if you haven't seen the previous videos, I request you to just go to the videos and have a clear idea of how to solve these problems. So today we'll have an idea of what this basically dynamic programming says. Okay, so this dynamic programming is you can say it is a mathematical technique, and it is dealing with, I can write it as mathematical technique, and it is dealing with the most common word we are using in every session of this operation research, that is a optimization. So it is a, you can say, the dynamic programming is a mathematical technique dealing with optimization of multi-stage decision problems. Okay, now you can see this particular method, or you can say this particular technique of dynamic programming, is very useful in various field of engineering, you can say, or business, you can say, or many other constructions problems and risks problems. So dynamic problem is particularly, from the name you can say, it is very much dynamic in nature. Okay, it is very helpful for solving multi-stage decision problems. Okay, the computer science guys are using this particular dynamic programming in developing newer algorithms in various of the websites, apps, and different fields of softwares. Okay, so this dynamic programming, you can say, is a very much dynamic in nature, and it can be very useful for solving a multi-stage decision problem. Okay, now this particular technique was developed by Richard Bellman. He was, I think, American applied mathematician, as far as I know. He was very famous. He also wrote a book around 1950s around. So you can say Richard Bellman, and one guy was also there. His name was G.B. Dantzig. So they both, you can say, developed the technique in around 1950. Now, in the beginning, this particular dynamic programming was known as stochastic linear programming, or you can say linear programming dealing with uncertainty. You can say stochastic, C-H-A-S-T-I-C, stochastic linear programming. Okay, and this particular term means stochastic, S-T-O-C-H-A-S-T-I-C, linear programming particularly means, as you can say, linear. You already know what does this linear programming means, as I already have made up various videos on linear programming, so you can also say it as a linear programming dealing with uncertainty, you can say. Okay, you also know what is uncertainty, when the outcome is not certain, or you are not certain about the outcomes. Okay, so that is the uncertainty. Now coming to this difference between dynamic programming and linear programming, what does that
particular characteristics you can say, or property that make difference with this particular, you know, dynamic programming with linear programming. So let us discuss the important properties. It differs from, you know, linear programming in mainly two ways. Okay, so first number you can say, in linear programming we have seen earlier in the videos I have made, you can see the videos there, you will find that linear programming we are using you can say a standard mathematical formulation in linear programming, you can say. Okay, so in LP, what we have, a standard linear mathematical formulation, like you can say we are having a objective function, say objective function we are having, okay, subject to some constraints. Okay, next we have non-negativity constraint also. So we have a standard mathematical formulation in LP, but in this particular dynamic programming, a particular equation must be developed to fit for each individual situation. Okay, so you can understand, in LP we have a standard mathematical formulation for solving the problems, but in dynamic programming we have to, you know, develop particular equation for each individual situation. That is the first important problem, you can say. Okay, now let us discuss the second point. Okay, so second point says, it says in LP we have, you already know, it gives only one time period, you can say, that is, you know, single stage, you can say. Okay, so single stage I can write solution. This linear programming, which we already have seen in the previous videos, gives one time period, you can say, or single stage solution. Okay, but in DP I can say it is as DP, that is dynamic programming. There is linear programming, this is dynamic programming. So DP considers decision making over time, you can say. Okay, so I can write decision making over time. Okay, so it is not, you can see, one period or single stage, you know, formulation or mathematical derivation, you can say. Okay, and also it solves each sub problem, you know, say this is the main problem, it is broken into sub problems. Okay, so you can say that in dynamic programming we have to consider decision making over time, and we have to solve, you can say, we have to solve each sub problem. These are the sub problems, you can see, each sub problem optimally. You also know what does that optimal means. Okay, so these two terms, you can see, optimality or optimal or optimal solution and optimization, are the key words or key terms in operation research. Okay, now where does this particular dynamic programming is applicable, or you can say it has got its you know, popularity? I can say in business there are many different type of problems, different type of environment, different type of situations which are very complex. Okay, now the decision variables, you already know what are the decision variables. Okay, so we have x1 or x2. Okay, so the decision variables dynamically interact with each other. In such situations where a sequence of interrelated decisions may be required for the solution of the problem, dynamic programming is to be used. Okay, so when we are having, you know, very complex situation where decision variables have to dynamically interact with each other. Okay, in these situations where a sequence of, you know, interrelated decisions may be required for the solution, then dynamic programming problem is to be used. To say it has been developed to solve a wide range of decision problems, including, you can say, let me write some of the important, you know, fields, you can say.
this will be this theoretical portion will be important for your, you know, university exams, semester exams. Okay, so you can say allocation. You can say allocation of, you can say finished products or raw materials, whatever. Okay. Mm-hmm. Next, you can say inventory control. You already know inventory control. Okay. Next, you can say say evaluation of investment opportunities, like share markets, you can say. Okay, SIPs. There are many type of investment, you know, opportunities. So I can write it opportunities. Okay. Now TIES. Okay. Now also there are, you know, in corporate they are using long term corporate planning, you can say. Okay, long term corporate planning and replacement also. So you can see there are various fields where dynamic programming has gained its popularity. Okay, now this particular dynamic programming is a technique for solving problems in which decisions have to be made at, you know, successive stages. Previously in linear programming, or you can say in nonlinear programming as well, we have solved in you can say in a single stage also. Okay, but especially in this particular dynamic programming, we have to take decisions. You can write it as we have to take decisions at each successive stages, you can say. Okay, now this particular dynamic programming provides a systematic procedure for determining the combination of decisions that maximizes overall effectiveness, you can say. Okay, now in this particular dynamic, why this dynamic indicates that it is particularly useful for problems where decisions have to be taken at several distinct stages. Okay, so you can write it as I already told you, that is the successive stages, or you can say as several, you know, distinct stages, you can say. Okay, and the programming is used in a mathematical sense of selecting an optimal, you can say, an optimal. I'm giving you overview of this particular, you know, dynamic programming. What does this two term means? Okay, so dynamic means dynamic, or you can say this particular term dynamic indicates that it is a particularly useful for problems where decisions have to be taken at several distinct stages, and the programming is used in a mathematical sense, you can say, of selecting an optimal allocation of resources, you can say. Okay, allocation of resources. Now, and also this dynamic programming, it has got also one more, you know, name, you can say, nickname, or you can say, okay, it is also known as, it is very important, recursive. You know, we will not be going much depth to this particular recursive optimization, but it is also known as recursive optimization, as because we have to check several stages. Okay, so there is a recursion, or you can say there is a repetition. Okay, that much you only need to know. Recursion is a wide term, or you can say recursion is a widely used, recursive optimization is widely used by the computer science guys in optimization. Okay, so you can say this recursion, you can also say this is as recursion. So this recursion is, you can say, is a parent of dynamic programming, you can also say. Okay, parent of DPI, I can write. So I can write it recursion as a parent of DP, you can write. Okay, now there does not exist a standard mathematical formulation of dynamic programming problem. In linear programming problem, we already discussed that we are having a standard mathematical formulation, but in case of dynamic programming, there does not exist a, you know, standard mathematical formulation of the dynamic problem. Particular equation, That is very important. You must write it or note it or take a screenshot. I will be writing it in a short way. Just stick to the video a little bit more. We will shift to the mathematical portion. We are having knapsack problem, and we are having a stagecoach problem as well. Stagecoach. So this is our syllabus in dynamic programming. In the first session, that is the today's session, we will be having introductory part or the formulation or the structure and the various characteristics and properties of dynamic programming. In the latter portion, or you can see in the next session of this video, we'll get to learn or we will get accustomed with this particular knapsack problem and stagecoach problem as well. Okay, so stick to the video till the end. I think you will be much more enjoying in learning dynamic programming with me. Okay. Now coming to this, this is a important property of dynamic programming. You must write or make a note. Particular equation must be developed in case of dynamic programming, and developed to fit for each individual decision, you can write. Okay. Now, as I earlier told you, we have to divide a problem into number of sub problems, and the solution, like this one, say this is a problem, we have to divide it in number of sub problems, say this one. Okay. This one, okay. Again, this one, say this one, like this, okay. So we have to divide the problem into sub problems, and the solution of the sub problems are then combined to get the overall solution. Okay. Now, mathematically, a dynamic programming problem is a decision making problem. You can say in n variables. You can say okay, n variables, and the problem being subdivided into, say again, n sub problems, you can say, or segments, you can also say sub problems or segments, you can say. Okay. Next, each sub problem being a decision making problem in one variable only. Now the solution to the dynamic problem is achieved sequentially, starting from initial stage to the next till the final stage is achieved. Okay. Now let us see some of the basic concepts of dynamic programming. Some of the important term relating to dynamic programming are, first one is stage, S-T-A-G-E. So what is stage? In dynamic programming, each problem is divided into sub problem, as I already discussed, and each sub problem in a stage, you can say. Say this one, we will be having a problem on Bellman's optimality. Okay, there we can see this particular type of structure. You can say in traveling salesman also we will be having this type of structure. So you can say these are the stages, these ones. Okay, so these are the stages. Say stage 1, stage 2, likewise. Okay, this is an example. So we have to say we have a problem, this one. We have to break the problem into sub problems, and each sub problem is a stage. At each stage there are a number of alternatives or course of action, like this one, say this one. These are the course of action, you can say, or alternatives, you can say. Okay. Similarly, this one also, say this one also. Okay. So you can see from each node, you can say, we are having this course of action. Okay. This one, or alternatives, you can say. And the selection of one most suitable and feasible alternative, may be called as stage decision. Okay. Now, these stages are very often represent
different time periods in the planning period of the problem, places, peoples, or other entities. Maybe it is a cost also. Okay. Now, for example, in salesman allocation problem, each territory represents a stage. We'll discuss with salesman allocation problem some later time. Okay. Now, coming to the next term, very important one, that is known as, you know, this is one, say, and this is, say, two. It is known as state variables. Okay. Now, the variables whose values specify the condition of the decision process. You already know state variables. From the term, you can know. And summarize the current status of the system are known as state variables. Okay. So you can say the variables whose values, say some variables, we have got some variables, say x1 or x2, we have some got variables, and whose values specify the condition of the decision process and summarize the current status of the system are called as state variables. Okay. These variables provide information for analyzing the possible effects that the current decision could have been the future course of action. Okay. State variables, we will be having a problem on stagecoach or knapsack where we will have a clear idea of state variables. For timing, for now only, you just know what are the definitive portions or the theoretical portions of state variables as well as stages and different other terms relating to this particular dynamic programming. Okay. Now, the state variables depend upon the type of the problem. Okay. So, I can write, it depends on type of problem you can say. Okay. Now, for example, in machine loading, say the amount of work allocated to the present stage and the machine capacity defines the status of the problem. Okay. Now, a specific city, okay, say in this one, a specific city, say this one or this one or this one, a specific city may be referred as a state variable in any stage of the shortest route problem. Say we have to find the shortest route from this source to destination. Okay. So, in this particular problem, a specific city may be referred as a state variable in any stage in a shortest route problem. Okay. Now, coming to the next important term, you can say decision variables. You already know, have a concept of decision variable from, you know, linear programming problem. So, decision variable, the unknowns. So, the unknowns, given in the problem that need to be determined actually, okay, that is known as decision variables. Now, the next one, so I just write it, that is the unknown given in the problem we have to determine, so that is a decision variable. Now, the next one is the return function. You can write it as return function. Now, what is this return function? Return function, it say at each stage a decision is made which can affect the state of the system to the next stage. Say we have to make a decision over here which will affect the, you know, state of the system of the next stage. Okay. It can be described in an algebraic equation form, this one, return function. Okay. The equation which represents the contribution of each stage is called a return function. Now, another one is very important, which I was telling in previous part, there is a recursive relationship. You know, this recursion, or already you know, the dynamic programming is sometimes called as the recursion optimization. So, recursion is the, you can say, parent of dynamic programming. Okay. Now, this recursive relation represents a mathematical expression connecting the optimal solution at earlier stages and the return function from the current stage. Okay. Now, I can write it, the recursive relationship is somewhat like, say, fn equal to, you can write, fn equal to rn, you can write, plus f of n minus 1. That is the previous one. Okay. N minus 1. So, you can write fn as optimal value. You can write optimal value of all earlier stages, you can write of all earlier stages up to and including I stretch, okay. And Rn you can write as a return function, okay. Return function at nth stretch. So this is very important, you know, recursive relations, okay. From this discussion, you can clearly have an idea. In dynamic programming, a decision is to be made at each stage and to the change of city, and thereby maximize the returns. Okay. At the next stage, the decisions are to be made with the help of state variables resulting from the previous stage and so on. Thus, the time component is considered here in two ways. I can write it or I can show you example or idea you will get. Say the process somewhat like that. Say period, say period 1 and say it is present, okay. Now say period 2 preceding, I can write preceding and present, I can write, okay, for period 2. Now say period 3 say. So I can also write preceding and present, I can write, okay. Similarly for say period n, I can write preceding and present. So you can see this is the idea of the recursive relationship, okay, where the time component is considered here in two ways: the present and its immediate preceding period. Okay. So this approach on mathematical representation of recursion found in continuous, you know, fractions. Okay. So this decision may have finite or infinite, you know, number of stages. You can see I have written period n. Okay. Now we have the steps, different steps involving dynamic programming. Okay. So in the first step, we have to set up a recurrence, you know, relating a solution to a larger instance, to solutions of some smaller instances. Okay. The second step we have to do, solve smaller instances once. Okay. Third one, we have to record solutions in a table so that we have to, we don't have to calculate the repetitions, or you can say, okay. So we have to record solutions in a table from where we can extract to use for the repetitions one. Okay. Now the last one says extract solution and use it for the next table. Okay. For simply, you can also write it in a different way. Say first step is the recursion, you can say. Second step, you can say state, or you can say memoize, and third one is bottom up. This is memoize, not memorize. It is not memorized. This is different. This is not memorize. This is memoize. Okay. So these terms actually very important in computer science algorithms, developing new, you know, softwares, apps, etc. Okay. So you just have a, you know, just a look on these particular names so that you might be acquainted with these particular terms. But we will just follow this, you know, elaborative steps. It will be easier for you to understand, as because we are from mechanical engineering background, so we'll be having some problem in understanding. But they are not so much too difficult to understand, you know. This I will also discuss with you, what is the bottom up approach. Okay. Now let us see, you know, forward and backward computation. There is one more important term, that is forward and backward computation. Now look, forward and backward computation. Say if the recursive equation, you already know what is the recursive equation, fn equal to fr plus fn minus 1, you already know. Okay. Now if the recursive equation, I will write it for you if somehow you forget, fn equal to, you know, that is say rn, I have to write rn plus fn
minus 1. You already know. So Fn is the optimal value of all RDR stretches up to and including I stretch, and Rn is the return function at the end stretch, you can write. Okay. Now say if the this recursive equations involved in dynamic programming problem are solved in the order say F1, then F2, okay, then Fn. That is the first find F1, then F2, and so on. And say up to Fi, say there is a term Fi. So Fi represents the optimum return for stage I. You can write it as optimum return for stage I. And all previously considered stages. As I was speaking, we have to take decision at each and every stages. Previously considered stages, you know. Then the computation, this type of computation in this direction, you can say, okay, from 1, 2 and so on, is known as forward. This is known as forward. Forward computation, you can say. Now, if the recursive equations may be formulated in a different way, say Fn, then Fn minus 1 comes to 1. Now, say, that is the first Fn, you can say, the first is Fn, then Fn minus 1, etc. This type of computation you can say as, you know, backward type. So this is known as backward type of computation. Okay. Now in short, you can say in forward computation, we solve stage 1 first. That is a stage 1, is this one. Okay. And then second and so on. While in the backward one, we are solving the nth stage. You can see nth stage, that is the last stage, and then n minus 1 and so on. Okay. In practice, you can write a note, this backward computation is preferred. That is more convenient. So we are going to use this backward in, you know, maximum cases. Now, there is an important term, you know, Bellman's principle of optimality. They are going to ask you questions on this particular, you know, this topic. They say they are asking, they'll be asking you write down a short note or describe the or explain the Bellman's principle of optimality in connection with dynamic programming. Okay, so you must know what this is, and you must make a note which will help you in clearing your semester examinations as well. Now, dynamic programming, you already know, is based on, as because Bellman was a founder of this dynamic programming. So dynamic programming is based on Bellman's principle of optimality. Okay, now which states I can write it? The statement is very important, you know, for examination purposes. So I can write it as the statement as an optimal policy or you can say a sequence of decisions. You can write sequence of decision as well. Has the property that whatever, this one is H, okay, so whatever be the initial state and decisions are, the remaining decisions, you can write, this is very important, you know, the statement, you must make a note. The remaining decisions, you know, must constitute, as we already discussed this point, an optimal policy with regard to the state resulting from the first decision. Okay. So this is all about the, you know, Bellman's principle of optimality. It says an optimal policy or a sequence of decision, you can say, has a property that whatever be the initial state and decisions are, the remaining decisions must constitute an optimal policy with regard to the state resulting from the first decision. Okay. Now, it implies that given the initial state of the system, an optimal policy for the subsequent stages does not depend upon the policy adopted at the preceding stages. As we have to, you know,
take decisions at each and every stage or state, you can say. Okay, now that's a wrong, you can say a wrong decision taken at one stage. So this is a stage, this is a stage, this is a stage, this is a stage. Okay, so you can say a wrong decision taken at one stage does not prevent from taking optimal decision, say this is the optimum, at the remaining stages. So you can see very easily that in linear programming we are making a single stage decision, okay, and finding the optimal value. Now for this particular dynamic programming we have to take decision at each and every, you know, state. Okay, so we are getting much optimal, or you can say when the problem is dynamic in nature, that is it changes at each and every stage, we have to take decision at that particular stage only. Okay, that is a, you know, basic difference between you know, linear programming, non-linear programming, or you can say basic programming and dynamic programming one. Okay, now I can write, or I can give you the statement of Bell-Lorentz principle of optimality, and or otherwise I will just shift to the problem solving using this Bell-Lorentz principle of optimality. I think I should give you a brief idea of the structure of Bell-Lorentz principle of optimality, and it will be much helpful for you for the semester examinations as well. Suppose say in a particular programming situation, you can say a particular programming situation demands that a certain quantity, say R, you know, of an economic resource, you can say, such as, you know, men or materials, you can say, okay, money, you can also say. So these are etc. You can write. So a certain quantity, say R, okay, is to be distributed among, say, n number of different activities. So the magnitude of return P, say this is the return, return P, depends upon the activities and the quantities of resource allocated to them. Okay, now it can conveniently be assumed for all practical situations that the return from activity, this is the, you know, return, this is the return. So this return from any activity, you can say, is independent of the allocations to other activities. Okay, and the returns from all the activities, this return from all activities, you know, can be expressed in a common unit so that the total return can be obtained by adding the individual returns. Okay, now the objective then is to, you know, distribute the available resources so as to maximize this particular, you know, return. We have to maximize this particular return. Okay, now say if PI, RI, say, you know, PI is the, you know, P represents the return, and R, you know, already R is the certain quantity, you can say, that is a man, material or whatever, you can say. Okay, now say this, if PI, RI represents the return from ith activity, say ith activity, okay, this is the return from ith activity, you can say, with resource, say RI, you already know R represents resource. Okay, now total return, say P of R1 you can write, R2 you can write, R3 you can write, or, you know, Rn, up to Rn you can write, that gives you P1 R1 plus P2 R2 plus, you know, Pn Rn as well. Okay, now the problem now is to maximize the total return given by this particular, you know, equation. I can also write the quantity of resource as R equal to, I can write also this quantity of resource as R equal to R1 plus R2 plus, you know, up to Rn I can write, and Ri should be always greater than, that's because this is a resource, this cannot be negative, so I can write it as Ri greater than equal to 0 as well. Now from these two equation I can say we have, our main aim is to, you know, maximize the total profit or total return. They are saying total return as well. Okay, so you just say return. So we have to maximize this total return, and subject to, you know, this is the constant, you can write, this is the constant. Now at this particular instant you can also write say now you know the problem now is to maximize the total return, you can say, okay, given by this particular equation and subject to constants, this one you already know. Now at this instant you can say, let us assume that R and N, this say R and N are the variable quantities, you can say variable quantities subject to restrictions that N be an integer also. N should be an integer. This is a restriction, you can say, okay. Now, say if Fn, we have got R max of say P R1 R2 up to Rn, okay, say equal to, I can write, say max of, you know, P1 R1 plus P2 R2 and up to, you can say, Pn Rn, okay. So that is the equation, and you already know 0 should be less than equal to Ri and Ri should be less than equal to R. This is the range, and that is all you can say, okay. Then Fn Rn, this one is the maximum return from the distribution of the resource R, you can say, or R1, R2, R3, you all know. These are the resources, okay. Now, let us now allocate the resources to the activities. These resources to the activities one by one, starting from the last, that is say, nth activity, okay. Now, we have to allocate the resources to the activities one by one, starting from the last, say the nth activity, you can say, okay. Now, say an expression connecting Fn of R, that is a resource, and say, you can write Fn minus 1 of R for say arbitrary values of N and R, now be evolved with the help of principle of optimality. Now, say if Rn is the allocation of the resources to the nth activity, okay, nth activity, I can say this Rn. So we have got Rn is the allocation of the resources to the nth activity such that say 0 less than equal to Rn less than equal to, less than R, I can say. Then regardless of the value of the Rn, a quantity of resource say R minus Rn, that is the remaining, you can say, will remain, which will be distributed among the remaining n minus activities, as because we have already allocated say Rn activity. So remaining is the total resource is R. So remaining is the R minus Rn. So this R minus Rn will be the remaining, and it should be, you know, distributed among how many activities? N minus n. Okay. Now, the return from this n minus one activities may be expected as, you can say, as if n minus 1 R minus Rn, so that the total return from the nth activities, I can say as Pn Rn, okay, plus Fn minus 1, I can write R minus R. The same thing, that is the return, you can write. Now, an optimal choice of Rn, okay, an optimal choice of Rn will maximize the, you know, this function. And thus the fundamental dynamic programming model can be written as in this way, Fn of R equal to maximization, say, of Pn Rn plus this one, this whole thing, you can write Fn minus 1, and this one you can write Fn minus 1 into R minus, you can write Rn, okay. And this range will be 0 less than equal to Rn less than equal to R, you can write also, or n equal to, you can write 2, 3, okay. Now, F1 R, I can write, F1 R can be determined with the value of the expression, you know, say Pi equal to Pi of 0 is 0, say, for each activity, okay. Each activity, I can write, okay. Now, F of N of 0 is also 0 and n equal to 1, 2. Okay. Now for f1 of r, I can write equal to p1 of r. Okay. Now this equation gives the return to be expected from the first activity when all the resources are allocated to it. Okay. Once this f1r is known equation, this provides a relation for evaluation of f2, f3 and so on, you can say. Okay. This recursive process ultimately leads to the value of, you know, f of n minus 1 of r and finally fn of r, at which the process is stopped. You can see this is the last process. So you can see this is the, you know, overall structure or general structure, you can say, of principle optimality. We will understand this better when we solve a problem, okay, directly. Now let us see with a problem. Say we have a problem of finding shortest path in a multi-stage graph, you can say. Okay, so you already know what is graph. Now say we are having these nodes S, A, B and T, C. Okay. Now look, we have got these alternatives as well, or you can say as paths, whatever you want. Now the weightage of these paths are also given over here in this particular graph. Say this one. Okay. Now say we have the values as well. Let's say this one is 3, this one is 5 and this one, sorry, this one is 1 and this one is 5. Okay. Now this one say 2, this one say 4, or you can say this one is 6 and this one 5, 7, or you can take 5 as well. Okay. Now say we have to move from S to T in an optimized way, or you can say we have to find the optimal value for traveling from S to T, that is source, or you can say source to destination as well. Okay. Now in order to do that, say we are applying greedy method. Now what is greedy method? You don't know what is greedy method. Greedy method is nothing but simply it is an algorithm, or you can more precisely say it is a way or technique to solve, you know, various problems as well, including this one also. You can apply this particular greedy technique. What we do in greedy technique, actually we are greedy about something. About something means we are greedy about, you know, profit. So we will be taking the profit as a priority. Say we are greedy about, you know, reducing the cost. Okay. So you can say we have to find the least cost path to move from source to the destination as well. Say we are greedy about weight. So we'll see which is the maximum weight. Okay. So in this way, we have to find the optimal, you know, solution of a particular problem. So this is nothing but, as in short, you can say the greedy method or greedy algorithm. They are very common in the computer science guys. They are using this greedy method in their daily algorithms. Okay. Now, if we apply greedy method, what greedy method actually does in this particular, shortest route problem. If we apply greedy method, say, these are the, you know, say for the timing, this is the cost incurred, say this 3, 1, 5. For this particular path, the cost of travel, you can say, is rupees 3, say. For this one is 1 and this one is 5. So when you are applying greedy method or greedy algorithm, whatever you say, it will first choose, say we are greedy about, you know, reducing the cost. So greedy method will seek which one is the least among these cost values. Okay. So it will automatically choose this one, this route, as it is the least one. That is the value of this one is 1. So it will block these two paths as well. That means it will simply take this path to move from S to A. That is the greedy method. That is the greedy method. Okay. Now, for the next instance, I can say you, for this path also, it will seek for the least value of the cost. Okay. As it is greedy about, you know, cost. So it will take this path and it will just omit these both paths. Okay. And for the similarly, for traveling from B to T, say, it will take this path only. That is 5, you know, and it will cut off this path. Okay. Now, applying greedy method for this shortest path, we can write for traveling from S to T. You can write S to T. Okay. Sorry for my pen. Say S to T, we have to travel applying greedy method, and the solution will be, or the optimal cost, you can say 1 plus 2 plus 5. Okay, that will give you 8. But is this your optimal solution every time? This one, applying this greedy method? No, as because this greedy method doesn't checks another pass. It only checks which one is the least one. If we take another bigger network, we'll easily understand the difference between a greedy method and a dynamic programming. Let us see. Now, let us have a bigger network, say bigger graph we have. Okay. You can see, these are the nodes. S, A, B, C, D, E, F, T. So, we have to travel from S to T. This is the source, you can see. And this is the destination, you can see. Okay. Now, the cost, say the cost of travel from this, you know, different paths. This is different alternatives, we can say. And these are the stages, you can say. These are the stages, okay, as well. Now, these are the 1, 2, 5, 4, 11, 9, 5, you know. For this one is the 16, and this one is the 2, this one is 2, this is 13, this is 18. This represents the cost you have to incur to travel from this different alternatives, okay. Now, we have to reach from source S to, say, T. Now, if we apply this particular greedy method as we applied earlier in this particular smaller network, let us apply and see what is the difference. Say we are starting from this one. So, applying greedy method, it will see which one. It will take only the lowest one. So, as because we are greedy about, you know, the cost, say. So, it will take this path only. So, it will just omit this path. Okay. Because this is the least cost path, you can say. Okay. Now, next, from this one, from here, it will reach here choosing this one, as because it is 4 and it is 11. So, it will choose this path and it will just omit this path. Okay. Now, from this one, it will, you know, have to choose, you know, 18. Only one path is given over here. So, applying greedy method, you can say SADT will be the optimal path. So, you can write for applying greedy method, we have got SADT. Okay. Say SADT is the optimal path in this case. For this SADT, the values will be how much? 1 plus 4 plus 18. Okay. So, that will give you 23 amount of cost, say. Okay. Now, if you see this path, say S, then C, then say F, then say T, this one. Now, if you carefully look at this path, the cost incurred, say S, C, F, T. So, the cost incurred, you can write 5 plus 2 plus 2. That is 5 plus 2, 7 plus 2, 9. Now, you can say there is a huge difference in between these two costs. First, we are applying greedy method to find the optimal path. In greedy method, what they are doing, they are greedy about the, you know, cost only. So, he will choose only, the greedy method will choose only this path and will omit this path, as because this is the lowest value among this alternative, both of, out of these three alternatives. Now, coming to this greedy method, we are obtaining 23 amount of rupees. But you can see this path gives you only 9 rupees. So you can say the greedy method cannot be applied to every processes. Now, let us see another problem that is very, you know, very popular one in our daily day, you know, mathematics as well as different fields. Fibonacci series. That is a very important one. So, Fibonacci series gives us, you know, already it is the summation of the previous two values. The first two values are 0, 1. Next comes 0 plus 1, that is 1, 1 plus 1, 2, 2 plus 1, 3, 3 plus 2, 5. So it goes on like this. That is the Fibonacci series. So you already know in the engineering mathematics, you have already learned about the Fibonacci series. Now let us say this is F1, you can write. This is F2, you can write. This is a F3. This is a F4. This is a F5. And this is, you can write as F6, you can write. Now the recursive formula, we already know, can be written as in the form of Fn. Fn minus 1, you can write. Plus, you know, Fn minus 2, you can check from this formula, you can check any one of the value, okay. Say, we are having F5. It can be written as, you know, Fn minus 1, that is F4, plus F minus 2, that is F3. So you can see F5, that is a 5. F5 is the 3. So it is a 3, which comes from F4. F4 is 2 plus F3. F3 is 1. So you can see this is the recursive formula. Now it is clear, I think, for all of you that what does this recursive formula does actually. And what is the recursive formula actually. Okay. Now, if you can see, we can break this, you know, problem into similar sub problems. Let us see how to break this one. Let us have, say, we have to find F6 in Fibonacci series. So let us write F6. Say F6. We have to find F6. How to find? We have to break into similar sub problems. You already know. Now, how to break, say, F5? Now, this F5 you have to break into another set of sub problems. F4 and say F3. And this F3 you have to again break F2 and F1 as well. Now, F4 you have to break again, you know, using this recursive formula, you can write as say F2 and say F3. And this F3 you have to again break as F2 and F1, you can break. Okay. Now, F2, F1 is gone. Okay. Now, this F4 you have to again break F3 and F2, you can write. And using the recursive formula, you have to again break F3 as F2 and F1 as well. Okay. Now, these functions, or you can say the values, you can write. Look, what happens? The particular, you know, dynamic problem goes somewhat like this one. The algorithm works in this process, in this path, you can say. This one, this process, okay. Now, you can check in calculating F6, we are having some values in a repetition. Look at this problem very carefully. Say, this F4. This is coming twice, you can say. This is coming twice, okay. Now, this F3, this is also coming twice, okay. This F3. Now, F2, this is also coming twice. Now, what do we have to do? This F3, F2, F1, they are coming in a repetitive way. So, in order to avoid twice calculation or the calculation of the same thing in a twice, we have to store these particular values, say F3, F2, this one, these values, we can store F3, you know, F2 value, we can already say, already we have calculated and stored. So, it will give you the optimal solution in a, or you can say, we can find this value of F6 in a much lesser way, if we can store it in a table, you can say, okay. Now, this approach is known as bottom up, you know, approach. You can see. So, in this particular Fibonacci series, you can say, I can also write the, you know, I can write the formulation as well, equal to, you can know, n if n less than 2, as because you can see this one, if n less than 2, then 0, 1 and 1. Okay. Or you can say this algorithm goes in this way. Fibonacci n minus 1 plus fib n minus 2. Okay. Otherwise, you can write. This is the algorithm. This is the algorithm, you can say. Okay. So, Fibonacci n can be found out, or you can say equal to n, if n less than 2. Or you can write it as Fibonacci n minus 1 plus Fibonacci n minus 2. That is this one. So, this is the structure of an algorithm for this finding a particular number in a Fibonacci series, you can say. So, this is a small, you know, example to help you in developing the concept of bottom-up approach in, you know, dynamic programming as well. Now, let us have the gist of the basic steps, what we are performing, going to perform in dynamic programming approach. First step, you have to identify the decision variables. Okay, I can write identify the decision variables and specify as well the, you know, objective. You can write objective to be optimized. Okay, so that is the first step. Now, next step, you have to divide the problem. I can write the divide the given problem. Okay, and into a number of sub problems. Number of sub problems you can write, or stages you can also say. Sub problems can be termed as stages as well. Okay, now each stage refers to a group of sub problems as well. Now, third step is to formulation of the mathematical model, that is the recursive equation connecting the optimal decision function fn of r. Okay, just like in the Fibonacci, we have seen how to formulate. Now, you have to formulate this decision function fn of r for the nth stage. Okay, for the nth stage as well, and with that of the, you know, fn minus as well, r minus rn, it can be written as for n minus 1 on a stage as well. Okay. This is a sub problem, you can say as well. Now, next step is you have to find the optimum value. So, I am writing optimum value f1 of r of each of the sub problems at the first stage. First stage, you have to calculate. Okay. You have to find. So, you have to find the optimum values f1 of r, okay, of each of the sub problems at the first stage. Next, you have to utilize the optimum values of the first stage to determine optimum values of the subproblems at the second stage as well and the successive stages. Okay, that is to obtain optimal decision function, that is f2 of r, you can say f3 of r up to fn minus 1 of r, you can say, and fn of r and as well. That will be the final stage. Okay. And the last step is, you can say, you have to backtrack. That is the bottom up approach, you can say, backtrack to find the overall, you know, overall optimal solution and its value as well at each stage. The problem may have, you know, more than one or many optimal policy. Okay. So, this is in short the basic steps of dynamic approach. Now, in the concluding part of the dynamic programming problem, let us discuss a little bit about the applications. So, you already know the dynamic programming is a, from the name itself, it says dynamic. So, it can be applicable to many of the fields to solve many types of problems. The only restrictions being that the problem involved must be capable of being splitting. That should be the restrictions. Okay. If the problem cannot be broken into sub-problems, then the dynamic programming approach is failed. Okay, that is the only restrictions, you can say. Now, coming to the application part, you already know we have got inventory controls where we can apply dynamic problems. We have replacement problems as well. Next, we have investment analysis. And production planning, you can say as well. Production planning, I can write. Production planning and scheduling as well. Okay. Scheduling of machines or whatever. The jobs. Then it comes to repairs as well.
repairing section and maintenance as well. And capital budgeting, you can say capital budgeting, and allocation of resources and bidding. Okay, allocation of resources you can say, and also bidding you can say. So these are, you know, various fields of application of dynamic programming. So I hope you have enjoyed and have a little bit of idea of what dynamic programming is and what is its difference with conventional programming, that is a linear one or non-linear one, and also the structure, the basic structure, or you can say the parent structure of dynamic programming is recursive relation. We have to broke the problem into sub problems. We have to develop a recursive relation and we have to solve, or we have to take decision at various steps or stages as well, you can say. Okay, so coming to the conclusion, in a word, I can say dynamic programming is remembering stuff to save time later, as we have to store a particular number that we already solved in a tabular form so that we can use that particular value in calculating the same, you know, function which is repeating itself. So you can say remembering stuff to save time later. Now in short, the characteristics is optimal substructure property. You have to break the problem into substructure, and another one is overlapping sub problems. Okay, and the methods generally are top down with memoization and the bottom up with tabulation. Now this is whole about the introductory class of dynamic programming. Okay, hope you have enjoyed. Please see my next videos on Knapsack as well as Stagecoach problem. We'll have more fun in that video as well. Thank you for watching. Thank you for your presence. Thank you very much.